Hi, everybody. I guess it's quarter after, so I'll get started. My name's Kyle Mcculloch, and I work at a visual effects studio here in London called Framestore. And I'm one of the compositing supervisors with the studio, and they've asked me to come out today to talk about a movie that we did over a year ago, Sherlock Holmes, A Game of Shadows. So I brought along some stuff to show you guys today about the visual effects work that we did for that film. It was a project that we were involved in from before they started principal photography. We did about half of the visual effects in the film and worked really closely with the clients and the visual effects supervisor in designing and building and executing the visual effects both before we shot it and then afterwards. So I've got pieces from about four sections that we did on the film, and I'm not precious, so if any of you have any questions or any comments at all throughout, feel free to butt in and ask. So I figure the best way to start is with a brief demo reel, which is something we always put together at the end of every film just to kind of show some of the work that we did. And so we can start with that. So that gives you a small idea of some of the work that we did in the film. And the first section I'm going to talk about is the train ambush. There was by the way, I'm going to spoil the film here, so if any of you haven't seen it and you're dying to, you should go now. Early on in the film, Dr. Watson leaves on his honeymoon with his new wife and very determinedly leaves Sherlock behind. Of course, Sherlock finds out that the bad guys are after him and are going to ambush Dr. Watson on the train, so he goes to meet him there. So the sequence involved a lot of different types of shots. It ranged from fairly straightforward work, which were shots that we shot in a practically built full-size carriage on a green screen. Most of these were interior shots that we did where the characters, the actors, were inside the static carriage on a stage and shooting dialogue and action inside the carriage. The trickiest bit about this was that we needed to maintain the reflections in the windows while still replacing everything that you see through them. So part of that involved underexposing some of the screens and working closely with the lighting team and the DOP as we designed these shots and shot it to make sure that we got what we needed for the visual effects team. The second piece of this work was figuring out how we were going to build backgrounds to put outside of the train. Because we weren't sure what we were going to shoot before they shot it. It was a really dynamic set and a lot of stuff changed as we were working on it. We knew we just needed to collect a large library of backgrounds that we could use in all of these shots. So we went out into the Severn Valley with a flatbed train with a cherry picker on top of it. And we rigged up a series of 8 film cameras on Libra stabilizing heads on this giant rig attached to the back of a train, which looked something like that. And from inside the next carriage in the train, we could view the output of all of these cameras. The idea being that we could run this rig up and down this long stretch of private train tracks and capture essentially a panorama of countryside running by a train track. And so this enabled us to build a large and dynamic library that we could use to build all the backgrounds outside the different shots for the sequence. Made it a lot easier for them to shoot freely on stage as they were doing green screens, because we knew we could fit a background for almost anything. And so, in the end, we used all of that footage to fill in all of the green screens in the sequence. So it was a nice, easy way that we were able to sort of make our work a little bit easier, make the client's lives a little bit easier. The sort of next step up in difficulty of stuff that we did was the computer-generated train. There were a lot of exterior shots that they wanted to put an actual train thundering by, and we couldn't get our hands on a pristine turn-of-the-century steam train. So we started out by going out in a helicopter and shooting some nice-looking plates that we were going to use as backgrounds to sort of help spice up the sequence and give it a real dynamic feeling and set it in the film. Obviously, the baseline of any CG integration into a plate is you need a very good camera track. So after we captured a good camera track, we went back on the set and captured as much data about the actual carriage that was built so that we could match it exactly, so that throughout the sequences we cut back and forth from the real carriage to the computer graphics or computer generated carriage, that'd be seamless. You wouldn't be able to tell the difference. So once we had all that data, we worked in our look development with a look development team, painting textures, working on lighting shaders and rendering so that our carriage matched up exactly with the one that they'd built for the show. We also needed some rigging help. We rigged up the different doors and shades so that we could get dynamic variants. The different carriages would be slightly different, so as the train goes by, they're not all exactly the same. We also had to rig up the connectors of the carriage, so animators, as they're animating this train through a scene, aren't having to manage each little connection, that the train would react appropriately as the animators pulled it across the tracks. From there, we'd render the whole thing against one of the actual trains that were built for the set. So what you can see here is our carriage on the left, and it's not as visible in the low light, but their end of a carriage on the right. We had to make sure that ours matched up exactly. Once we knew we had that, then we could fill in the inside of it. We didn't see inside the carriage too distinctly throughout the sequence, so we did a rough model of what the interior of the carriage looked like. And then we needed our locomotive. So the clients went to the York Train Museum and picked out the steam engine they wanted. They picked the exact one they wanted. So we went up there and captured, again, as much data as we possibly could about it, taking hundreds and hundreds of photographs, measurements, and sampling the different textures and reflectivity of the different surfaces. Brought that back and built our own model to match up exactly. Again, it got the same treatment as the carriage, so basic rigging work to make sure the wheels turned and the connectors would react with the carriages appropriately. The last piece of any good steam train, obviously, is going to be your steam. So our effects team, working with Houdini and NIAID, more Houdini for this simulation system, built us a steam rig that they used throughout the sequence to make our steam. From there, put the whole thing together with a bit of grating and some matte painted fluffy clouds, and you're left with a fully realized dream. So the last bit, which probably was the trickiest in this section, were shots in which we needed to integrate or mix the real carriage that we shot on set with the computer-generated carriage, along with real plates, CG steam, and other matte-painted elements. So when we put it all together, we'd end up with a shot that looked something like this. So what you're seeing there is a combination of a plate that we shot on set, and this is not motion-controlled, so we let the crew shoot the camera move that they wanted to shoot. And then later, we went out, again on that same train track, and did our best to emulate that camera move with the background. This is probably not the fanciest way of doing it, but it enabled us to do it cheaply so that we didn't have to get motion control rigs on each site. For those of you who are familiar with doing work like this, when you're gonna mix two live plates together, it really helps if their cameras are doing exactly the same thing. And so you wanna use a robotic system to make sure the cameras perform exactly the same. We didn't have that advantage on this shot, so we were eyeballing it. What we ended up doing is tracking all of the different cameras and finding some different object tracks for the foreground and the background, and actually ended up using the Foundry's Nuke to bring the cameras together and massage the two plates and the two cameras in such a way so that the shot green screen footage would fit into the move on this background. So once we were able to do that, this is just showing you what that foreground looks like once we sort of skew it into place so that that carriage sits on the tracks in our filmed plate. We put our CG train into the same environment to make sure that it sits on the tracks and we've got our carriage. And then we put our plate on top of our CG train, add some steam and a matte painted bridge in the background to give the effect the director was looking for. So, one section of the train ambush involved Sherlock being very clever. Guy Ritchie, who directed this film, was really interested in visually showing the audience just how smart Sherlock Holmes was. And in addition to that, he's something of a gun nut. So he really wanted a moment where we watched Sherlock's knowledge of how guns work execute a very, very complicated booby trap. So what we knew going in was that we were going to see Sherlock somehow cause a shotgun to backfire and set some people on fire. And when we were there on set, we really only knew those two pieces of the story. So we shot a couple of plates, this being the first one, where we just very slowly tracked up the length of a shotgun that one of the stuntmen was holding. From there, we started prevising some different ideas, trying to show Guy Ritchie different ways that we could tell this story point. He wanted us to see the stuntman fire, he wanted to see the bullet ignite, and we weren't really sure how we were gonna fly a camera through a gun to do all of those things. But to start with, we obviously needed to be able to fly into the gun, that was a big thing that he wanted. So we started by building a CG gun and realizing that even really high resolution textures weren't gonna hold up that close. So first we tried to, you know, the old compositing tricks of blurring it and putting it out of focus a little bit, but it still didn't look good enough, so we went back in and hand-painted some really beautiful high-res textures that would hold up even when you push the camera that close to it. From there, we had to make sure that we were doing everything right. We did a couple of previs where we were showing different ways the camera could fly around the action and show the director what he wanted to see, and every time we did something that wasn't physically accurate to this particular type of gun, he'd call us on it and send us back to the drawing board. So it required we really learn exactly how this shotgun worked, how the shotgun shells for this model worked, and eventually came up with a previs animatic that the director was happy with. The trick here was that he didn't want anything to feel, this sounds silly, but impossible, in that he didn't want to feel like the camera was flying through the wall of the gun or squeezing in between a bullet and the edge of the barrel. So finding an action that satisfied those demands of the director while still looking really cool was the biggest challenge of this, and we did a lot of different versions of trying different things and putting it together different ways. In the end, we kind of got something that he was happy with, so then we had to build the inside of the gun. So that was our animatic that he finally signed off on. Once we got that, we started modeling, texturing, and lighting the inside of the gun. This is based on a real shell casing and the real mechanics of the bullet. Spent a lot of time really working up this look and working up these textures for this kind of a macro feel where you're inside of the gun and experiencing this moment in time. The second half of the shot, obviously, was setting the bad guys on fire. And again, when we were there on set, we really weren't sure what the director wanted or even how we were going to do it. So the best we could come up with is to have them react to a light flashing. And for any of you that work in film, you'll know there's quite a bit of, we'll just fix it later in visual effects. So we were left with that. And so our solution was to do a rough body track of the actors and then give it to our effects team, who again were working in Houdini primarily, to create some different flame ignition elements for us. And in the end, this piece of the shot really came together through compositors working with a lot of real elements that we shot and some effects elements that were rendered for us until they finally got something that the director was really happy with. It's a bit over the top, but Guy really wanted you to know that they were on fire. So once you had all of those pieces, finished shot. We had one of these sequences, and the other primary vendor on the show, MPC, had one of these sequences, and talking to my colleagues at the other facility, they went through about as much pain and suffering on their sequence as we did on ours. Theirs involved a really big gun flying around, watching the ignition pin fire. But when you're on a Guy Ritchie show, you're going to do something with guns, so that's what you get. The biggest shot that we did on the film was the waterfall shot, and it was without a doubt the most challenging. It involved the most different disciplines at the facility and was the part of the film that we were involved with from the very beginning, even before we shot. They knew that this was this moment that they wanted to have in the film and they had no idea how to execute it. At this point, before we shot Sherlock, my facility was involved in the early production work on a different film where we were investigating the use of car assembly robots to do visual effects work. And so that's one of the reasons they came to us for this, and you'll see why in a second. So again, much like the gun work, we started with previs. We tried a bunch of different ideas and a bunch of different camera moves because Guy really wanted this moment where, for those of you that haven't seen the film, I'm very sorry to tell you this, but Sherlock had to sacrifice himself to kill the bad guy at the very end. So they throw themselves off a balcony and fall down this waterfall. Some of the things that Guy was really insistent on was that this fall last for, you know, 90 seconds, and that we see the action, we see the fury in Moriarty's face as he realizes he's lost, and we see the sort of complacency in Sherlock knowing that he's done the world a solid by getting rid of Moriarty. So in a bunch of the different previs we were doing, this, for example, wasn't satisfactory because while we can see what Sherlock is thinking, we can't see Moriarty's face. And the director really wanted to know what happened with both of the characters. So we tried a different angle where we follow them from below and we watch them pass us to get a moment with both of the characters. And while this was starting to get into the realm of what the director was looking for, it wasn't quite good enough. If you've seen any of the Sherlock Holmes movies, you know that Guy Ritchie loves to use slow-mo, these moments where you really see how clever Sherlock Holmes actually is. So he asked us to incorporate a bit of that slow motion into this camera move. So this is what we ended up working out, where we see them falling towards us, and then time slows down as they pass us, so that you have a moment to really see each actor's face and read the story points that both of them are trying to tell. So this is all well and good to do with low-res models, sky's the limit in previs, but the problem is we had no idea how to shoot something like this. It's obvious that we're gonna get really close to our actors, and we're gonna see them for a long period of time on the screen, and so there was no way we could do this with CG. We just couldn't pull off CG characters performing at the level that the director wanted and have our audience buy it completely, have it look totally real. So we took a different approach. As I said, we'd been building up to another film that we were gonna work on where we were investigating the use of robots. This is something now that's starting to become really prevalent in visual effects, but at the time, no one had really done this yet. So these are called Kuka robots. It's the company that makes them, and they're primarily used in car manufacturing and amusement park rides. They're incredibly powerful and totally customizable, so you can program them to do anything that you want, and they'll do that same action again and again and again. So we figured there might be a way that we could use these robots to help us create this shot. So we got a couple of them, and we put them on a stage where we spent a couple of weeks working out exactly how this was all going to work. Now, obviously, because we'd done the previs work, we knew exactly where the camera needed to be, we knew exactly where the characters needed to be, so we reverse engineered the whole move. If they weren't actually falling through space, and the camera didn't move as far as it did in the shot, where did the two actors need to be? And using that information, we programmed the robots to mimic that motion. Now, expensive Hollywood actors don't like to be uncomfortable, so a big piece of it was finding a way to put them on the ends of the robots both safely and comfortably. So each actor had a Kevlar bodysuit molded on them so that it would fit them exactly and hold them really comfortably. They each had a stand-in who spent the long weeks running up to the shot doing that and getting flung around by the robots. Early days, there was a lot of twitching and spinning, which we ironed out so that at the end, the robots did the same consistent, safe movement each time we tried to film the shot. Here's another shot of building the leg harnesses, the ropes that would hold their feet comfortably. And the third robot in all of this is our Cyclops. This is what I was referring to earlier when we were talking about some of those train shots. The Cyclops is a motion control rig, which is, again, another computer-controlled camera rig that can put a camera in space at exactly the same place and same time every time it runs. So all three of these systems had to work together. In the end, because they were based on such different computer systems, the way that we went about doing it was infrared sensors. The person driving the whole shot had a control board where they could fire different lights. And each different robot had an IR sensor that was just watching a single light. And so the moment the lights went off, all the different robots would trigger and move. And this became very important because if the camera robot went flying by at the wrong time, then the car robots were going to be holding the actors exactly where the camera was going to be and someone was going to lose an arm. So we did this again and again and again to make sure we were going to get it right. Once we had our setup, we needed to figure out how we were going to film it. And because it was so slow motion, at the time there was a new camera on the market called the Phantom Flex. And Phantom cameras, for those of you that know, are really good at shooting very, very high frame rates. So that was exactly the camera that we needed to use for this. But the problem is, when you're shooting extremely high frame rates, in this instance we were shooting 432 frames per second of footage. And when your shutter only sees the light for that short a period of time, you need an awful lot of light to expose correctly. So once we put all the lights up on the ceiling and lit up the stage, we still didn't have enough light to expose the film correctly, or rather the digital correctly. So we got a bunch of a material called Miraflex and coated the floors of the stage with it. So what you can see there is the entire stage was coated in mirrors to bounce the light up from the ceiling and double the amount of light our actors were going to get hit with for the shot. So again, we ran it again and again and again with our very patient stuntmen, making sure we got this right. Because again, when you have expensive Hollywood actors, they don't like to sit in rigs for a long time and they don't like to do things more than they have to. So we knew we were only going to get a couple goes at this once we got our actors into the rigs and we had to make sure that everything worked right. So this is one of our witness cams filming Jared Harris and Robert Downey Jr. in one of the three takes that they did together. And you can see the Kuka robots are controlling their motion while the Cyclops is holding the camera that flies by them in real time. And what it actually looks like from the position of the camera on the Cyclops rig is this. Another one of those things where you've spent weeks and weeks and months doing something and you get to watch it all happen in about 30 seconds and you hope you got it right. So they did this three times together. It was great. We were all patting each other on the back. And then Guy Ritchie comes over to explain to us that he doesn't like Robert Downey Jr.'s performance in this take. But Jared Harris, Moriarty, is done shooting. He's out of his rig. So we do a second take of just Robert Downey Jr. And now, in addition to having to put the whole shot together, we're going to have to take the face off of this performance and put it into the other performance, where Moriarty is there. But as you can see, once you let the footage run at its full 432 frames per second, you get some pretty sexy slow-mo footage, and it's your real actors really performing. So we crossed that bridge where we didn't have to try and create really great-looking CG characters up close. The thing was, it's a good point, all of this was probably almost as expensive as doing CG humans, but this we were pretty sure we could do. CG humans, I think the jury's still out on some of those. And besides, we get to play with robots, so. There's always, you'll see in a couple later clips, half the people that get into this is just so they can play with really cool toys. And this was, for me at least, the sort of penultimate moment of playing with some really cool toys. So obviously, then, everybody who just stood and watched these robots do this wanted to know if it was going to work. And so what you're seeing here is we had a live setup on stage where we dumped the live feed out of the high-speed camera into a computer and had a rough snowy mountainside in there, and we were able to, in real time, play back to them roughly what the shot was going to look like when we put it together. So again, you had a bunch of people standing around sort of trusting that the nerds who were driving the robots knew what they were doing, and this was another way that we could sort of make everybody feel a little bit calmer that maybe this was all going to work. Seeing the way the shot was going to come together was really encouraging for everybody involved. But of course, they got to wrap that day. It was the last day of shooting, and then we spent a year putting the rest of it together. So obviously, once you've got this green screen footage that looks really cool, you've got a lot of cleanup work to do. The rigs were huge. It changed the shapes of their bodies. And there was no easy way for any talented paint crew to fix that. So we started with a couple of body tracks that we did of the characters, and this, again, was primarily to enable us to align pieces of replicated costume and to fix the shape of their bodies. If you look closely, both of their bodies are about twice as wide as they should have been because they've got these Kevlar suits on under their tuxedos. So we had to do digital doubles of both characters, not only for the cleanup work as they passed the camera, but Guy decided that as they flew away from the camera, they wanted to make sure that you understood that Moriarty goes to one place, which is dead, and that Sherlock goes to another place, which is not dead. So they had to fly away from each other far further than our robots could reach. So at some point in the shot, we were going to have to take over with CG characters, but fortunately, they were going to be small, and we weren't going to have to make them look quite as good as if they flew right past the camera. So once we got our digi doubles of the two characters, we used those body tracks that I was showing you to do some really some renders of different clothing pieces. This is what our paint and roto team then took to help repair all the different patches of the body to try and get our characters to look like they weren't wearing Kevlar suits. And this is just a quick example of one of the waistcoats plugged in for Moriarty, removing his rig. This cleanup with the head replacement on Sherlock took about 6 months of work. So it was quite a bit of paint and roto and cleanup work. For any of you that have done that kind of work, you can sympathize with our team. So as I said, the performance at the end of the shot wasn't quite what Guy Ritchie was looking for. So here you see our animators demonstrating kind of the different path that the two characters will take. This is called a digi-double takeover. So it's the moment where your characters line up with the people in the shot, and then they go off and do whatever the animated action is that the director's asked for. And so once we had all of those pieces going, then we had to find our waterfall. We weren't able to find a waterfall to use, an actual real waterfall, because none of them are 2 kilometers tall. So we started the search for what was going to be the basis of the waterfall in this film. And it was a process that did take quite a few months to find something that both Guy was happy with, that met the needs of the visual effects team, and that we were able to get to. So the first one we started with is Reichenbach Falls, and I don't know if there are any Sherlock Holmes fans in the audience, but the story of Sherlock falling off a waterfall to his death is how the last Sherlock Holmes book ends, and it is set at Reichenbach Falls in Switzerland. So this was where we started, and we went to check it out. Unfortunately, it's not very tall, so you're not going to get a good 90-second fall off of this waterfall. So from there, we went and looked for a bigger waterfall. And we found Martelsfossen, which is in the north of Norway. And it looked like this was going to be our waterfall. This was going to be the place we were going to go to shoot the background for this shot. And this was one of the better experiences of my adult life because they sent me out there in a helicopter. So we got to the site and shot a ton of reference photography. We shot models and textures, everything we needed to use this as our background. And here you can see some of the textures. And in the end, in the finished waterfall, there are pieces of this waterfall that we did end up using. The problem ended up being it was far too remote and far too cold to get the crew out there that we needed to shoot the plates and the elements and all the other pieces that we were going to need to fill in the background of this shot. So I got a helicopter right out of it, but it wasn't what we ended up using. Our third choice was Yosemite Falls, one of the largest waterfalls in the world, and a little bit easier to get to. So we sent a recce crew out there to go check it out and figure out if it was going to meet our needs, if it was going to have easy access, have the right height, and the right look for the director. And this is what they sent back. because we asked them, we needed to make sure that we could get to the top of the waterfall. This is the best part. As much as I wanted a free trip home, no, this one didn't end up working out. Part of the problem was access, and part of the problem was it's too popular. There were a lot of other film crews looking to work in Yosemite, and it was going to be really difficult for us to get the crew that we needed at the time that we needed and the access that we needed. So no, we didn't end up using Yosemite Falls. We did finally find a waterfall that met all of the requirements in Canada, and that was Hunlin Falls. And this had the right look that Guy liked. It had easy access both to the base and to the top. There were plenty of available crews to go out and work with us and helicopters to rent. So this was what we ended up going with. Part of what was great about it was that it was very high. It had that secondary hit about halfway down, which was something that Guy was really interested in seeing. He wanted to see something dynamic, not just a straight column of water. And it was really easy to get to. So this was the waterfall we ended up using. So because it was slow-mo, water is a really difficult thing to make in the computer. And we knew we were going to be able to make water for the beginning of the shot where we're looking up the waterfall and water for the end as we're connecting with the characters flying away from us. But we wanted to get as much of the rest of it as actual physical camera shot elements as we could. So again, we got that same camera, the Phantom Flex, and shot it at a 432 frame rate, tied it to the bottom of a helicopter, and we went and flew around in front of the waterfall for a whole day, shooting plates that looked like this to use as elements, basically, in our shot. In addition, we knew that the bottom of the waterfall looked like what Guy Ritchie was looking for. So with the same camera, we shot the down angle, our character's end, as it were. And once we got those, we brought them back here to London and started working on them. Again, because we didn't have match move data, it wasn't all shot from the same camera move, we had to get really creative in how we were going to get these water elements to fit in with this camera move that the robots had executed for us 6 months before on the stage. And a lot of that came from clever camera tracking from our camera department and also, again, working a lot in Nuke. We use Nuke very heavily at Framestore, and we were able to do lots of different sort of hacky, planar tracks, camera tracks, different image manipulation to try and get that slow-mo water to stick behind our characters. But of course, it wasn't going to be enough, so our effects team went to work building different pieces of water to use throughout the rest of the shot. This is an early test just showing a Houdini system of the waterfall itself. And then we started working on what it actually looks like when our characters fall over the top. This proved incredibly difficult because the further away you get from the emission point, the higher the volume of water is. And for any of you that do effects work, you know the higher the volume, the more particles you need because we're still close to the water. And our server and render farm fell over with this. So we switched to a system called NIAD, which I won't pretend to know a lot about because I'm a compositor, not a 3D guy. But we got really good looking water out of NIAD. So this is one of our finished renders of the water system coming off the top of the waterfall. But as you can see, it only gives you sort of the beginning of the waterfall. And we know we've got some of the middle bit from those plates that we shot in Canada. We also wanted to be able to connect up to the bottom of the shot, which is the plate that you shot. So this is something called V-shapes, which is the shape that water makes when it's falling. You get these V shapes in the water itself. And so again, using Houdini, we were able to build a huge library of different elements like this that our compositors used to assemble the connection between the slow-mo characters and then the bottom of the waterfall. Here are those V-shapes fully rendered. So the last bit, obviously, is spray. You want to put your characters into the water and make it feel like they're getting wet and they're, you know, falling into it. So we started out with some early look development on the droplets themselves. We wanted to ask the director, well, how much should they wobble? So we started there, showing him different wobbling droplets, and of course, he liked them all. So we had to build a system that could use all of them. We started out, again, using Houdini and different effects systems to try and build these falling particles. But the problem for us was that we couldn't turn it around fast enough, and we couldn't change it fast enough based on the feedback we were getting from the director. So at the time, the foundry that makes the software Nuke had just released a new version of their software that did particles. And we took a risk and decided to do all of our particle work in the compositing software. So what you're seeing here are falling droplets that are all generated inside of Nuke and not a 3D package, not a traditional 3D package. From there, you had a little depth of field, which is, again, a compositor's favorite tool. And your droplets start to look pretty good. Once we got that, we had all of our pieces, and we put it together. So that's the waterfall. How am I doing on time? Cool. This was the end of the film. As it was written and as we shot it, they really wanted to leave it very mysterious. Does the hero die? So we did that. And this was the film up until about 3 months before the movie came out. And then studios often do test screenings, where they show these films to sort of test audiences to gauge their reaction, find out if it's working or if it's not. And the feedback they kept getting was, well, what happens to Sherlock? Does he live or does he die? So the studio came back to us and said, we realize that we've got to set it up. We've got to, you know, leave a door for a third film to make some more money. And we want to make sure that our audience knows that Sherlock has, again, outsmarted the bad guy. So we came up with three different ideas. There were three different endings that we could do. And they asked us to sort of go with it and do one of them. One of them required a lot of visual effects work, basically, and that was we actually see that Sherlock survives at the bottom of the waterfall. So this is your spoiler, because this is not in the film, nor on the DVD. So this was the alternate ending that we put together for them, which they didn't end up using. So again, we knew we had to get into the bottom of the waterfall to see Sherlock sort of outsmarting us again and surviving underwater. So we needed a waterfall where we could get in the water at the base of it. In Hunlin in Canada, that wasn't possible. So again, we went looking for another waterfall. And we found one in Iceland. So it was a relatively short waterfall. So what I said about visual effects nerds and their toys, the VFX supervisor for the film is also an amateur miniature helicopter pilot. So we sent him to Iceland with a rig that the special effects guys built. That is a GoPro camera and a torpedo, which we dropped into the base of the waterfall, figuring, oh, we hope we get something out of this. And it came back after the divers went and fished it out, and this is what we got, which is actually pretty freaking cool. So from there, we went and got Robert Downey Jr. back, went out to the water tank, and shot some plates of him hanging out underwater with his turn-of-the-century breathing device. It's really, really hot in that tank. I want everybody to be very, very comfortable. So if you're not in the tank, you're sweating because it's 100 degrees in that room, or 40 degrees in that room. So we shot some footage of Robert. We also threw a stuntman in there to show what Moriarty's body floating by might look like, and the red notebook, which is a plot point if you've seen the film. So here's our Moriarty dummy. Best part of this is his one job was to not breathe, because he's dead. We did it again and again and again, and every time he breathed. So, again, our paint roto guys got to work removing some bubbles. And again, we went, the comp team went into Nuke, built some dummy cameras, kind of bringing the elements together, just some rough rock shapes to kind of show what it would look like. And we showed this to our visual effects supervisor, and he came back to us and he was like, well, I can see kind of how it's all going to work, but Guy's not going to be able to get what we're going for here, so we need to work it up a little bit further. But at this point, maybe a month and a half from the movie coming out. We don't have any crew left. We've finished everything else in the film. So we got a matte painter to paint us some rocks. And the comp team, again, took what we had, kind of roughed everything into place. And again, using Nuke to create some bubbles and some particles, built the finished shot for them. They didn't go for it, so it's not in the film. But that's what I brought. I hope it was mildly enjoyable, and I'm happy to take any questions you guys might have about the work that we did. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
The bulk of our budget. The waterfall. I think it was, I'm going to say, I don't remember the numbers, but it was almost 2/3 of our total budget for that. It was a very big endeavor. Fortunately, we don't pay for the robots. So everything that happened on the stage was covered by the film, by the production. And then all of the effects, the simulations, the water, the elements, all of that came out of our budget. But, you know, we worked with them from the very beginning, so we sort of bid out what it was going to cost for us, and it went a little over. Water is tricky. That was the lesson that I learned.
You said you worked on that show for 6 months getting advice.
Mm-hmm. What
kind of numbers
of artists? It would depend. The man days ran into the hundreds. It was just one or two guys for long stretches of time. And then as we approached the finish, I think we had a team of 10 artists full-time doing cleanup just on the two characters, between replacing the head, fixing the bodies, removing the rigs. It was a lot of work. So it was really kudos to them for doing such amazing work and making it look right. We had a great team. Anyone else? Well, I'll be here for another 10 or, oh yeah. You were the ones that were supposed to do our scan in Norway. Well, so some of what happened is we went out to Norway to shoot the textures, and we were going to meet the LiDAR team. And for those of you that don't know, LiDAR is a laser-based system that can scan an object and create it in 3D space for you so you can use it as a model. And the weather gods got in the way. We got snowed out, and the LiDAR team got stuck somewhere in a different part of the country and couldn't fly out. Our helicopter was stuck as well. We managed to get a backup copter or backup chopper to get that one day out to take the pictures, with the plan that the LiDAR guys were going to free up and go shoot it later in the week. And then I think you were stuck for a week and a half. Yep. And in that space of time, in that week and a half, they figured out that they wanted to use a different waterfall. So for Hunland Falls in Canada, we didn't end up getting a LiDAR scan of it, in part because by that point we had started building our own model for it. And so we used a lot of the photography and a lot of the plates that we shot to texture it. But we ended up sort of building our own. And in the end, that was what we needed to do, because of the way that the robots were moving the actors, the geography had to be really specific. So even if we had used the Norwegian Falls, we would have drastically altered the layout to make it work. So, sorry you got snowed in. Anybody else? Well, I'll be here for a few more minutes, so if any of you have any other questions, feel free to come and ask. Thanks very much for coming. Oh, yeah. Sorry, what was your question? It's a good question because we use two completely different cameras. Obviously, a GoPro is a pro-am camera that people use, and it's very durable but doesn't shoot great-looking footage. And then we use what did we shoot with? An Alexa, I think, in the water tank. In the end, it didn't matter for us to match the lens distortion between them because we had this impact moment where it went totally black when we were in the water before we came up on the Alexa footage. And because what you saw actually wasn't really a finished shot, it was as far as we got to get to the test screening for the studios for them to show it to their audience, and the audience to say, no, it's too literal. So we stopped work on it at that point. But we may have done a little bit more. Probably what we do in that case is we try and undistort the GoPro camera and then redistort it using the distortion profile of the Alexa just so that they have the same feeling. Sometimes you can get away with doing something like that. So. But if you've got more questions, come ask me. I'll be here for a few more minutes. Thanks again. I really appreciate it.